Welcome. This is a lecture about blockchain. And before we start, I would like you to Google Ethereum wallet Mist and go to the GitHub Ethereum account for the Mist browser and scroll down. Current version is 0.8.9. If you scroll down, you will find executables for various platforms. So get yourself the executable for your platform, install it now and start. While we are discussing blockchain technologies, your wallet will sync up, and then at the end of the lecture, we will be able to do some experiments on the testnet network. So I have already downloaded it and installed. And then if you launch Ethereum wallet, it will connect to the peer-to-peer network and sync up with the other peers and start syncing the blocks. It will take a couple of hours. It's important to go to the develop option, menu option, and change from the main network to testnet. There are two networks. There is the main normal network with the Ether being worth money, being able to exchange it on the various exchanges. And there is a testnet, which is basically used for testing. Mining on the testnet is relatively straightforward. You can leave your laptop running for a couple of hours and mine some Ether for yourself. So then you can do some experimentations and testing of the various smart contracts. So I encourage you to do that, to start it up. And yeah, by the end of this lecture, you will have hopefully some Ether mined. So we will be able to play with it. It's very important for you not to mix main network and testnet. Never send money from your mainnet to the testnet address, because that effectively means your money are lost. Because the testnet address is not a valid mainnet address. So you can, you know, easily get screwed. The other way around, normally the mainnet addresses will not accept if you try to push money from testnet. So your transactions will be effectively rejected because it cannot be verified on the mainnet. Okay. I have recorded this lecture for the digital forensics course. Unfortunately, the first 25 minutes of the class doesn't have an audio, so I'm kind of recording the audio now after the fact, post-mortem, so dubbing myself. So I'm trying to watch the lecture and dub the audio, which was the original one. So for the first 25 minutes, I will be basically talking to you about the discussions and about the slides that we had in the class, but it's not the original audio, which kind of happened. The microphone was turned off and we lost the first 25 minutes. So apologies for that. I try to do my best. So we have two parts. We have the blockchain with the focus on Bitcoin, and then we have a more generic discussion about economics and finance aspects of the cryptocurrencies, and then we will discuss Ethereum and smart contracts. First, let's start with me talking a little bit about myself. Then we will discuss, you know, who are you, what do you know already, and then we can try to do some pre-lecture questioning before we start discussing the material. So first about me. I'm a computer scientist. I'm a lecturer at the computer science department of NTNU Jovik. I've been working with various programming languages. I'm really keen on programming. I'm really happy with the degree that we have here, which is very programming centric. I just recently learned Go, and I quite like the new programming languages. I try to learn a new programming language every year to get up to speed with the latest developments in the software engineering space. I really like working with peer-to-peer systems, decentralized and mobile systems. I believe that the future is in that space. It will be in distributed computing. And I'm really interested in autonomous computation models as well. So the how to make the computers do more than they currently are capable of. I am also teaching game design and game programming. I'm really keen on game jams and hackathons. This is from a hackathon in Dublin, where together with the other 5 people, we won a Fidelity Investment Award for the most innovative blockchain app on the Bitcoin blockchain for sharing and gratifying artists. I also like, you know, to balance my life, and after hours and hours in front of the computer, I like to go out. So I'm really keen on running, climbing and paragliding. If any of you does any of those sports, please let me know. I'm keen to find new climbing and paragliding spots. The longest run I've done so far was 160 kilometers. It was in one of the 24 hours running events. Subsequently, I ran 130 kilometers in the mountain marathon. So I'm keen on long distance running. Right, here we talked a little bit about you, but I cut that part because without voice, you know, we don't know what the students were answering. Okay, so this part of the lecture was reviewing some of the basics about basic fundamental computer science concepts. And we started discussing hashing, what hashing is. So effectively, it's a one-way function which takes some arguments and produces an output, the function takes one argument and produces one output. And the argument is from the input space and the output is in the output space. And we want the transformation to be unique and not possible to be reversed. So given a particular output, we should not be able to compute what input was used to calculate that output. That's what makes hashing. We also want the input space to be much larger than the output space, which means we will have, you know, statistically speaking, collisions. So not everything which is in our input space will map to a unique output element. But we want those collisions to be sort of unpredictable, to be random. So we don't want an attacker to be able to force a particular input to match an existing known mapping already done previously. That's what we kind of call collisions. And the accidental collisions, they kind of happen. They will happen statistically speaking, but we want them to be very rare. So we want the output space to be large enough that those collisions kind of accidentally happen, but you know, we can often assume, given a particular system, that they are so rare that we can ignore them. We also would like to have an avalanche property, and we discussed with students what it is. And here I'm going into the notes for the slides and demonstrate what an avalanche property is. So given a particular input string, if we just change one single character, the resulting output is gonna be completely different. So here we have an example of this is a long text to be hashed, which I hashed using a RIPE-MD hashing algorithm. And you see it starts with 5D, 9 to A, and so on. And then I just added a dot at the very end of this sentence. And as you can see, the resulting hash of the same string with the dot at the end is completely different. There is no single character which repeats in the second hash. So this is what is known as an avalanche property. What it means is hashing in the output space is uniformly distributed and completely unpredictable. This is a property which we want, but sometimes we also would like to retain some properties of the domain space arguments in such a way that we can do some computations on the hashes. So imagine a case where I have three values, you know, Alice, Bob, and Charlie, and I would like to hash them in such a way that if I order them by value, I will retain the ordering if I sort them in the domain space. So if I say Alice, Bob, and Charlie are sorted, and A comes before B, which and B comes before C, so I have Alice, Bob, Charlie, then after hashing, I would like to have hashes which also retain that ordering. So this type of hashing is called property preserving hashing or similarity preserving hashing, and it's useful for homomorphic encryption and for some of the computations that we want to be done in secure fashion without revealing the data, underlying data. So there is a separate research field which actually works with hash functions which don't have the avalanche property, but retain some of the similarity metrics from the domain space. Also, I asked the students about RIPE-MD, but most of them didn't know about it. It's kind of one of the hashing algorithms used in Bitcoin and other blockchain technologies. And here we're kind of discussing the fundamentals of peer-to-peer technology. So in peer-to-peer computing, messages or information is being shared directly between the peers, between the nodes. This is in contrast to centralized systems where the message exchange is always going through a central point, which is like a single server or some sort of a cloud service. So imagine, you know, in Facebook, if you want to send a message, it has to go to the Facebook servers and then it goes to your friend. You cannot kind of directly communicate with your friend. You always communicate through the Facebook central server. It's not a single server. It is kind of a distributed system in its own, but it still represents kind of a single point of failure. So if Facebook shuts down, you can't really message your friends. In peer-to-peer messaging systems, you can directly communicate with your peers, with your friends. So here we are discussing a little bit about Gnutella and file sharing. So, you know, the fundamental concept of how would you share a file between users. So one user has a file, and then others want to download it from that node. So you start downloading, but then if that node goes out, you know, you stopped. You can't download the entire file. So to make the system more robust, you want redundancy. You want multiple peers already to share the same file. So then you can download the file up to certain length from one node, and then the moment this node goes out, you can ask another node to continue downloading from that checkpoint. So this is a very simple mechanism for making the system of file sharing more robust, to share information, some metadata about various files, and make sure that different peers which have the same file know and advertise it. So then users who are downloading can kind of download parts of the file from different locations. So how would you make file download more efficient? Well, you would like to download from multiple hosts at the same time, right? So in a simple Gnutella system, what you could do is you could start downloading from one node a file from location 0, and while you're doing that, go to location 100 and start downloading from that location from another node, right? So then you'll be doing two concurrent downloads from two different nodes instead of having to wait for the entire file from a single download. So So here I'm kind of explaining the concepts, and I will draw on the whiteboard the concept how it would work. So while I'm kind of downloading from one node from location zero, I can at the same time be downloading from another location. So this assumes that I'm kind of limited on the input from the particular node. So the speed that I'm getting, I can on my input is larger than from any individual node that I'm downloading. So here I'm just drawing the idea that I said. So from one node, I started from location zero, and then from another node from location 100. To make this possible, I have to know that the file that I'm after is exactly the same file on multiple locations. So how could I do that? And I ask students about it, and of course the easiest answer is to hash the files. So if we hash the content of the file, then we may basically, and the hash matches, we're basically making sure that the binary sequence that resides on one of the nodes and on the other of the nodes is the same. Otherwise, it wouldn't hash to the same value. You know, remember the avalanche property. So we can push this concept further and say, by default, we will truncate and split all the files into chunks. We'll hash those chunks, and then we will advertise those hashes to the network. So then anybody is looking after a particular chunk, whoever has that chunk already on the computer, they can share it, right? So I not only share data from peers that already have the file and are sharing it, I can share the chunks that of the file that I'm currently downloading with others who need that particular chunk that I just happen to have. So I don't need an entire file to be already participating in the network. I can have one or two chunks already downloaded, and while I'm waiting on, 99 of other chunks to be downloaded, I can be already sharing the ones that I have. And that's the basic idea for BitTorrent. So BitTorrent democratized the way sharing is done, and then everybody who is downloading is already participating and sharing the files, which means it balances off the people who are only downloading and people who are only sharing, such as in GNUtella system, and making the system much more robust. All right, so how do we find information in the peer-to-peer network? So here I moved on to the concept of consistent hashing. So what is consistent hashing? Well, the basic idea is very simple. We use as the same hash function to calculate the hash about the physical location of a given node. It could be the IP address, or it could be an onion address from the Tor network. And we use the hash to hash the content of the document. So if I have a number of documents which need to be accessed through the peer-to-peer network, I would use a consistent hashing to hash the documents and the location of the nodes in such a way that I can type the location of the document with the accessibility of the node. So imagine that I have a number of files, and those files are hashed, and then I have a number of peers. The IP address of those peers is hashed as well. And now I would like to find a particular file in that network. How would I do that? Well, I need some form of distributed hash table. I need some sort of mapping between the hashes and the document location and the document content. So with consistent hashing and with making sure that the hash of the node is the same is in the same space as the hash of the document, what I can do is I can have two rings. I can have an inner ring, which is my nodes. So those are all the hashes of the nodes. So if you imagine the space of the hashes as some sort of a large space with nodes being points on that space, I can have an outer ring, which are the hashes of the documents. So here I'm drawing those document hashes on the outer ring. And one of the possible algorithms is to attach the documents to the node, which is just after the hashes of the documents. So the hash of the node and the hash of the documents are kind of in the same space. So I'm kind of now attaching the documents which are handled by a particular node, right? And then if you want to find something, you just calculate the hash of the document, and then you have to find the next node, which is slightly larger than the hash of that document. And that will be the node which stores the document for you. So this is basically a QORT algorithm. So here I'm kind of discussing the DHT bullet point, and there are two very well-known algorithms used for this, QORT and Kademlia. And then I just explained QORT. It's a very simple idea. Here we're discussing who is using IRC, and only one student was using it. It is not a very popular messaging app anymore among developers, but it is still quite useful for peer-to-peer networks and for synchronization. So it's important to understand internet relay chat, how does it work. And yeah, there are still some activities happening there. So I encourage you to kind of to install the client and know. And here we are discussing FIFO and LIFO and other models of queues or linked lists or lists and stack. And we're discussing what are those used for and what those are first in, first out, last in, first out models are for, how they work. So the basic concept here is that depending on your objectives, you can use a different data structures to make it most efficient for the implementation. And we are effectively narrowing down the discussion to understand that for some of the simple operations, the best way to pass arguments around is through stack, because it decouples the actual operations from the parameters that those operations operate on. So I'm kind of very quickly describing stack and drawing kind of a simple graphical representation of the data structure, which is sort of like some sort of container which you can push elements to, so numbers or strings or what is the domain that you're using. So a push operation kind of pushes a particular argument onto the top of the stack, and pop takes the argument out. And that is pretty much it. So you can push and pop arguments from the stack, and this basically is fundamentally first in, last out. So that would be a FILO type of data structure. Why do we use it? Well, we use it mostly because passing arguments in operations is kind of costly in terms of the architecture itself. So we would like to decouple the operand passing, and a lot of virtual machines are using it. Here we are discussing basic concepts around public-private cryptography. We're discussing DSA and elliptic curves. So the question to students was, why do we use elliptic curves instead of other models for private public key cryptography? The answer is that elliptic curves have certain properties which make it much smaller and more efficient in representing hashes and encryption keys while returning the same guarantees and the same constraints on the search space. So given the same parameters, we can have the same guarantees with shorter keys and shorter hashes. Here we're kind of discussing private key used for hashing. So if I hash something with a private key, then somebody can verify that the message wasn't tampered with. So it is kind of used like a proof of authenticity. And then conversely, if I encrypt something with my private key, with somebody else's public key, then the owner of the private key will be the only one able to decrypt it. So then we can use it for, you know, a form of ownership proof. So, you know, private public key cryptography is very useful, and it provides us with this anonymous pseudonymous identity. So whoever owns the private key, they retain a certain identity, and only them can kind of prove the ownership and the authenticity of their messages can be proven by the public keys. So this is pretty straightforward. The students sort of understood it. This is a class for first year master students. So most of them had strong cryptography background. So we just discussed basics here. Okay, so after that, we went to discuss distributed databases and what does it mean to have a distributed database versus a traditional single database system. So the students were kind of they knew the concepts, they knew the differences. So I asked them we discussed the concepts briefly, and then we kind of summarized it by, you know, discussing that a very simple model where, you know, a database is basically like a store of values or key value store of some sort or store of documents, and then nodes connect to it and access data, read and write. It's very easy to maintain a consistency of such a database because it's a single place, but, you know, it's also a single place of failure. So to make the system much more robust, we'd like to provide redundancy and split the data across multiple nodes in such a way that a single failure of a node doesn't affect us. So yeah, we want to use some sort of a distributed system. So we have a number of nodes which together represent our database. So all of them are sort of like a database for us, and any client can connect to any of the nodes to access data, write and read. And then you have multiple models for replication and redundancy. You can make the data partially redundant. So between multiple nodes inside, you have the data being kind of split and, you know, into shards or whatever you're using. Or alternatively, you can push it to the limit and make the data redundant fully. So each node of the peer-to-peer network basically stores the entire database. So if every single node stores the entire database, then, you know, effectively that's the maximum robustness you can get, because you would have to take down all the nodes of the network for the system to stop working. And that's the model which blockchains are using. So they effectively make every single fully validating node to replicate entire database in such a way that, you know, you have to take all the nodes down for the system to stop working. Otherwise, it will be robust enough to continue working.
Now it's on. Okay. That might be pretty bad for the first part of the lecture if it wasn't on from the start. I didn't notice. All right, so what is barter? Okay, we go back to it. What is money? You know, is Bitcoin money? Well, okay. So I have a couple of slides. How are we doing with time? Okay, 9 o'clock. So maybe we have a 5 minutes break, and then we dive a little bit into economic discussion, and then we come back to the technical discussion. So let's have a short break, 5 minutes. Okay, restarting. Okay, so we are at the point of discussing some of the economics topics. Why do you think it's important? Yeah, it is fundamental, yeah. And also, it is important from the context of virtual currencies and blockchains to classify things for regulatory purposes and so on, right? So at the very beginning, Bitcoin wasn't clear how, and it's still in many countries, it's kind of unclear of what it actually is. Is it classified as a kind of item, which means it goes with VAT and with the typical product taxation schemas, or is it classified as a currency and it goes with all the financial things attached to it? Do you need to track all the customers, like with know your customers type of, you know, money laundering schemas, or you don't? So we don't know, and the technology is kind of developing, so that is a little bit of a moving target, so it is unclear. So it is kind of good to understand a little bit of the basics. So I have a couple of slides about money. And money is kind of an invention. We didn't always had money. We were, as a society, kind of using other means for value exchange before we invented money. So in the early societies, we had something which was called gift economies. So people were not buying and selling things. People were just doing their own thing and then helping others in need. So in New Zealand, so I spent 16 years in New Zealand, and they had a kind of a long tradition of giving gifts to someone who needs it. So if you have a neighbor and they had bad year and they have less crop or whatever, then you just give them help. You give them your potatoes or whatever, right? 1 year. And then the next year, when they have more, they kind of give you a gift back. So it was sort of you give them a gift, which means you give them something they need right now. And then in the future, they will give you something you might need, or they give you something that you don't need, but they give you more of it, right? So it was this kind of idea of koha. And we still have it. Like we still have this kind of a tradition of giving gifts for birthdays and so on, right? It kind of comes from those times. Those are the behaviors which kind of remained in the society from those early societies. So it's kind of good to celebrate and to share and to give gifts as a form of spreading the wealth around the society, right? So if you have more and you can give to others, you kind of do that to your family or whatever. So so with pre-money era, we had this sort of gift economies. And then we had barter-like exchange method. So barter is, instead of using money, you actually exchange things, right? So if you're producing... if you are a farmer and have potatoes, you can buy milk from the guy who has cows. So you take your potatoes to the guy who has cows, and then he gives you milk in exchange, right? And they were doing it, but it has some problems. So one problem is you have to have this double coincidence of wants, right? So if I want milk, the guy with cows needs to need potatoes, so we can kind of do the exchange, because if he doesn't need potatoes, he has a lot of potatoes, I will not get my milk, right? So at some point we kind of developed some sort of common commodities like barley or gold or silver as a kind of a common property, so you can store it. And then even if you don't need barley right now, you can get barley and give somebody milk because you know you can take this barley to somebody else and get, you know, apples later on. So instead of exchanging everything for everything, they kind of emerged some common commodities which were exchanged more than others. And they had certain properties. So based on this model of the commodity money model, we kind of developed the representative money model. So we developed something that represents this kind of value, and it's a social contract of what it is. So one of the interesting ones are the rhinestones. Have you heard about those? Yeah, you can check it out later on. It's kind of an interesting story that people used massive, huge, rock stones as a currency because it had certain properties. Like one property was that on one island there were no rocks to make those kind of stones, right? They had to travel on those little boats to another island, take those giant stones, carve them in those kind of round shape and bring them back. And that was very, it was very difficult to do. So whoever managed to get this huge block had kind of social value, right? And then I can exchange my house for it. And then because it has the social value, I can buy another house for it, right? So I can actually use it as a currency, as a token. Of course, it's very non-divisible, right? You cannot kind of easily split it and so on. So you have to keep track of who owns which one, right? So if I have this one by my, by my house because I brought it from this other island, I took a lot of days and so on and a lot of work and I have it now, but I bought a cow for half of it from my neighbor, then half of it is now my neighbor's and half of it is mine, right? So we have to keep track of who owns what. And you can check it out here. So they range from, really huge ones to smaller ones, and then the huge ones were more valuable than the small ones. Anyway, it's kind of a interesting history because it relates to some of the properties of representative money which we observe now. For example, this proof of work. Those stones were valuable because they were really hard to get. They had also the value because they were scarce, right? So on this particular island, not many people had them, and they kind of, that's why they represented the value. And it's similar with gold, right? So gold has kind of a limited supply, and that's what generates the kind of the value of that particular particular commodity as a representative money. All right, so it basically, if we think about it, money has three properties. So one, as with this barter exchange, it's a unit of exchange. So I can use it to exchange something I have for something I want in the future. If I don't have money, then I have to do this double coincidence of wants, because what I have, somebody else needs to have to want, and they have to have what I want at the same time. If I use money, then we sort of make it more asynchronous. So I can currently have something, I can exchange it for this medium of exchange, and then in the future I can exchange this medium of exchange for something I want. The other thing is the unit of account. So we can keep track of who has what, right, by representative money. And then the last one is a store of value. So I can build up value for myself and then use it as a store of value. So then when I need something in the future, I can sort of exchange it. So it relates a little bit to the first one, but it's not in a form of exchange. It's just in a form of storing a value for myself. All right, so all those properties kind of evolved, and we as a society evolved to use more and more representative monies. We had an era where we were backing up the representative money with some sort of commodity, like in US, United States, the currency was backed up by gold at some point, but then they decoupled it. So we kind of moved to electronic transactions and electronic representation of money. And we have, you know, different terms for it. So the key property here is that the exchange just happens electronically. There is no physical representation of the money anymore. So we have electronic fund transfers protocols, which banks use, or where you use the card to withdraw cash or pay for things. We have the digital gold currency. So there have been a number of those and others. And we have some, you know, some other systems where you can play in games or in some sort of betting sites, and you get a representative money, which is like a currency, but it's not real. It's just kind of a medium of account in a particular system. So, you have kind of gold. And if you compare PayPal to the kind of digital gold currencies, this digital gold currency is a little bit more like cash, because it has the property of being less traceable, right? So I can sort of give it to anybody, and it has kind of cash-like property compared to the PayPal, which is more like credit card-like. So credit card networks are kind of managing the statements and managing the value of accounts by having this kind of a distributed system, but with a central authority. With the decentralized systems, like, you know, cash, there is no central authority which keeps track of who owns what. It just happens. So if I have the particular banknote in my pocket, then I'm the owner. But if I give it to you, then you're the owner. But there is no central authority which kind of tracks that. So we have the concept of soft and hard currencies. So soft, it's kind of like PayPal or credit card, where the system itself manages of what is happening, right? So typical properties is that clearing time is long, because a lot of moving parts have to agree that the transfer actually occurred. There is a mechanism for handling disputes. So if I say I have been charged at credit card transactions, but I wasn't at that hotel, that transaction can be overturned if it hasn't reached a certain point, right? So I have ability to do that. Things are kind of tracked. With hard electronic currencies, we have irreversible transactions. So once the transaction happens, that's it. So it's the same with the cash. If I give you my, you know, banknote, then you have it, and that's it. If you give it back to me, that's another transaction. But I cannot reverse the act of giving you the money. And there is no built-in dispute handling, so that has to happen kind of in peer-to-peer fashion or ad hoc. The clearing, the transfer usually is super fast because of the non-reversibility of the transactions. So most electronic currencies, and Bitcoin is not the first one. I mean, we had currencies which were electronic before Bitcoin. So we need computer network for the system to work. We need some sort of cryptography system to make it possible. We usually link it to real money. So like those digital gold currencies, they kind of link to gold, or they link to United States dollars or something. And we use some form of blind signatures. So have you heard about blind signatures before? So that's another small technical detour. How does it work? Well, imagine that you want something signed, but you don't want to show the content of what is being signed to the person who is signing. So that usually happens when you have the person who generates the content and the person who signs the content to be two different people, and you want to maintain the anonymity of the content itself. So you don't want to reveal what the content is, but you want to be able to sign a content without knowing what it is and then verify that whoever signed the original content, that the content didn't change and it's, you know, the same content after transfer happens. So the Alice and Bob and the envelope example is a kind of a standard example where you imagine that you have Alice who wrote a letter and she wants Bob to sign that letter, but she doesn't want Bob to see what he's signing. She just needs to know that the letter has been signed by Bob. So when she gives it to somebody else, the other person will see this letter has Bob's signature and hasn't been tampered with. So, and Bob have signed it. So how does it happen? Well, you have a special envelope with carbon, kind of carbon copy on the inside. So Alice puts the letter in that special envelope, sends it to Bob. Bob, without breaking the seal of the envelope, signs it on the outside. So that makes a carbon signature on the letter, gives it back to Alice. Alice takes the letter now out of the envelope and she has the original letter with the with his signature, right? And Bob is sure that, because he checked the seal on the envelope, so Bob is sure that he signed the original letter, and then Alice can show the letter with the signature and somebody can verify that it hasn't been tampered with. Relatively simple idea. So where do we use it? Well, we use it for electronic currencies, for digital currencies, and we use it for voting systems. So usually when you have a voting system, you want kind of some additional authority to verify what have you voted for, right? So it's the same as with the envelope. So you go to a voting booth, you cast your votes, and then you put those into the this kind of digital envelope, and then you give it to an official who signs it without looking what votes you casted. So then when the votes are verified, they can be verified, but at the time of verification, your vote was unknown, right? And that's the idea. Okay, so and one more concept. So we were discussing distributed and centralized systems before, and in the context of money and financial services, we kind of see that, you know, all financial services are centralized. There is some sort of a authority or management organization or a network of companies or banks and so on who manage that. And we don't really have systems which are, you know, truly decentralized. We used to have them in society based on those barter or commodity or gift economies, but we sort of don't really have it anymore. So there, you know, historically, you could say we sort of evolved towards centralized finance. And there is a bit of a gap. So that's, you know, that's where Bitcoin came into play. So in October 2008, anonymous group of people published a paper on the cryptography mailing list. And then a few months later, they released the first software, version 0.1, with the initial block. And that's what started the blockchain. It is a decentralized currency, so it sort of follows the tradition of barter economies. But at the same time, it's not a barter because inherently it doesn't have any value in itself. It's just a representative number. And it has been, you know, quite interesting, both from technological and social perspectives. It is a form of electronic currency. It is basically a software system, and it is a distributed database. So we discuss it here that each node has the full copy of the entire database of transactions. So we have three main stakeholders. So we have what's called a fully validating node. Okay, so that's a computer which runs the software, and we have a network of those fully validating nodes. And in the original, okay, so let's do this to the finish. So we have fully validating nodes. Then we have nodes which are special because they generate the blocks. So we call them miners, right? So those are the participating nodes which have enough hashing power to generate new blocks. And they are, you know, the number of miners compared to fully validating nodes is, so there are order of magnitude less miners than fully validating nodes. At least that's the assumption. And then the third stakeholder is users. So the owners and people who use the currency, right? So you have those kind of three stakeholders. And with the original white paper, they were kind of amalgamated into the fully validating node. So a fully validating node was, so if I say fully validating node and a wallet for a user and the mining software for the miner, it's one and the same thing, right? So that's how it started. And then the hashing became harder and harder and harder. We talked a little bit about it in a moment. So then the split happened that the miners kind of became separated. So we had mining nodes which were having enough hashing power to mine, and fully validating nodes were running the wallets. But now we have wallets being on mobile phones and on portable devices and so on. And then we observing that splits. So miner point split there. And then the wallet also kind of splits because a fully validating nodes often don't run a wallet at all. They just do confirmation of the transactions. And then the wallet is kind of separated into a thin client or into kind of a cloud service. So there are some mechanisms which are sort of slightly different to the original idea. And there is no central authority, no clearing houses. It's a peer-to-peer payment system. Transactions are irreversible. So once the transaction happens, it's done. And it is verifiable and cache-like in a sense. So there will be total of 21 million Bitcoin at some point. We are around 75 or so percent done. The smaller unit is one Satoshi. One Bitcoin is dividable up to 8 decimal places. So you have, 100 million Satoshis per Bitcoin. And the transaction is basically a change of one account value to another, right? To another person. So we go back to that in a moment. I want to go back to the original thing that started this, which was what is barter and what is money, right? There is one more, is what is ledger. So blockchain is often described as distributed ledger technology. You've heard that term? So what is ledger? So as with those big Rai stones, sometimes you have to keep track of who owns what, right? So let's say 6 of us form a community, and then I came here with $100 and I gave, I gave 10 to one of you and 10 to another and so on, right? So we have 4 people. We have Alice, Bob, Charlie, and Damian or someone. And then Mariusz. So I came here, I had $100 at some point at time zero, and you guys had none of those. And then I gave Alice $10, I gave Charlie $10 and Bob $10. So then after I've done it at time one, I should have 70 left, right? So that's basically the ledger, right? So the ledger is kind of a statement of keeping track of what happened in time. So time flows downwards, and at time zero there was this kind of initial state, And then there was a transaction happening which said, Mariusz gave $10 to Alice, $10 to Bob, and $10 to Charlie, which means that after this transaction happened, that's the state of account, right? So then if Charlie gave $5 to Damien, then these guys have this, and there was a transaction 2, which said Charlie gave $5 to Damien, right? So how Bitcoin does it? Bitcoin does it exactly as I just said here, right? Everybody is identified by the public key. So if I redo this and I say I have public key 1, public key 2, public key 3, public key 4, and the initial public key had 100 units of account with that public key, and I am the owner of this public key because I have the private key attached to that public key, then I can make a transaction which says from public key 1, I'm transferring 10 units to public key 2, right? So with this transaction, I'm transferring 10 units to the public key 2. So I have 90 left and 10 goes here. But it doesn't work like that, okay? Why? Because in Bitcoin, if this is my 100 and I have my public key 1, each transaction which happens on that public key has to spend the entire amount, right? So any transaction that happens on the public key has to spend whatever that amount is entirely, right? So what does it mean? Well, it means that if I want to transfer 5 units or 10 units to P2, what I have to do? I have to spend 10 units to P2 and 90 units back to that address, right? So then we say this is a transfer. I'm transferring 10 units to P2, and this is a change. So it's like having a $100 bill. If I want to spend it, I cannot tear it and keep the, you know, part of it. I have to spend the whole thing and then get 90 back as a change. So it's the same here, right? So in fact, I have a single transaction, but that single transaction has 2 outputs. One output goes to P2 and one output goes back to me, right? This is frowned upon because that means the funds can be easier to track, right? So typically what happens is the change goes to P1 prime, some newly generated address, and then I have, you know, P1 prime public key with 90 in it. This one got emptied because actually the transaction is spent. This guy has P2 with 10 in it, and that's the end of the transaction, and that's my transaction which I just did. Okay, that still is a change, but if you don't know which one is which and you don't know which address belongs to whom, you cannot really tell, did I spend 90 and got 10 back, or did I spend 10 and got 90 back, or did I just bought 2 things, one which costed 90 and one which costed 10, right? Most transactions are one-to-one, which means I buy something and got change back, but you have to discover which one is which. So from forensic point of view, and if you're tracking the transactions, Bitcoin is actually really good because, you know, from day zero, it keeps track of everything of whoever sent transactions to whoever, and it allows you to traverse those kind of directed graphs, right? So if you go back to the original original transaction, original block, what you end up with, you have this sort of a ever-growing tree of transactions of directed links, but some of which kind of go back, some of which might go back like this. So it's, you will have cycles and you will have kind of a complex structure of the picture of how it looks like in terms of spending and so on. If I did that transaction and I spent both like this, and this is zero, I still have the private key to this. So in the future, if somebody else sends funds to that public key, I can spend them because I have private key, right? So to send funds to anybody, you need to know the public key. But to spend them, you need a public key. But to spend them, you need to know the private key of that public key address. Does it make sense? Okay, it's a little bit more complicated than that. What's the complication? The complication is that this adds up to 200. But if you try to do this transaction on the network, it will be rejected. Why? Because you have to give some money to the miners. You have to give something back for them to do their work, right? So those have to add up to something which is less than the unspent output. So this transaction, that address has some links which kind of come into it. So those are the inputs, and some links which go out of it, and those are the outputs, and the difference is called unspent output. So if I have, I don't know, 1,000 things coming in, and I have 990 coming out, that means I have 10 which is still unspent, and I can spend it. I mean, whoever has the private key can spend it. So if I want to spend that remaining 10, I probably have to do like one over there and 9.99 or something like this. And then what I will have is 0.01 is left, is actually not anywhere, right? So one goes to P2, 9.99 goes to my newly generated address, and then 0.1 is like not spent. Where does it go? It will go to the miner. So let's have a quick look at some of the. All right. So if we go to blockchain info, it's one of the tracking software which tracks of what is happening with this distributed peer-to-peer network. So we can see here that 2 minutes ago, a block number 459,290 was generated, 3 minutes ago, and it contains 1,800 transactions in it. Total money involved in those transactions is 10,000 bitcoins, and it has been mined or relayed by this Bitfury is a mining operator. So those are all kind of mining operators which are either pools, or most of them are pools. And then we have a 1 megabyte limit on how much the block can be. So we can see that in the recent past, almost all miners are kind of hitting the limit, right? So we have a new block. As you see, this one was pretty fast. It was, you know, less than 3 minutes apart. a typical distance between the block discoveries should be what? 10 minutes. So on average, every block should be generated 10 minutes. But we see it took 18 minutes here, it took 6 minutes here, and 3 minutes here. So it varies widely. But on average, it should be, roughly speaking, 10 minutes. So if we go into that last one, we see that... come on. We see that there is... it's really slow. So we see this value here. So what it means is there is a number of transactions in a block. In fact, it's like 1460 transactions. All the inputs of those transactions are summed up, and all the outputs of those transactions are summed up, and the difference is this. And that is what has been coming in but never left, right? And as I said, what comes in has to be fully spent, right? So what will happen if you do this? You have, let's say you have generated yourself an address. So you have a public, address, and then you gave it to somebody. Somebody transferred you 100 bitcoins, right? And you say, hey, great, I have 100 bitcoins now, right? I'm really rich. So I will make a transaction and I will send one bitcoin to my mom. So she will be happy that she has one bitcoin, right? So you generated an address for your mom. So your mom has now public mom address. She has a private key somewhere stored safely. And you make a transaction, and you said, from unspent outputs of this address, I want to transfer one BTC to my mom. And that was the only output out of your transaction. What will happen? Yeah. So whoever mines this transaction and puts it into a block will say, yay, they got 99 bitcoins as a transaction fee, right? Because this clears up. Every transaction has to clear up whatever the input is. So the input for this transaction is the unspent output of this address, and then unspent output is 100. So the input is 100, and the output of these transactions is 1, which means the fee is 1 minus this, so 99, right? So 99 bitcoins in a fee. If you traverse the Bitcoin history, you will find some mistakes sometimes. And you can discover, you know, that somebody's transferred somebody something somewhere and forgot about the rest, and then the rest got swollen by the mining block, right? So what will happen here is you will see that the first transaction in any block is special, and that transaction contains a reward. So miners get reward for doing their work, and currently the reward is at 12.5 Bitcoin. So 12.5 Bitcoin is the reward plus all the unspent stuff from the inputs. So 12.5 plus this becomes the first transaction which transfers that value to an address, right? So we know it was a Bitfury. Oh no, this one is GB miners. So let's get back to the Bitfury one. So this one, we have 1.3 was a transaction fee. So here is 12.5 plus 1.3, which roughly means 13.8. And then if we check the address of the Bitfury mining company, we see that there is 1,200 transactions coming to that address, and the total received is 16,000 bitcoins. And the current balance is 6,000. So it means 10,000 was spent, but 6,000 is still sitting in this address, right? So typically, the miners collect all the fees to a single address for, you know, tracking purposes. So they want to be transparent. They want to say, we discovered that block and we got this reward, because they have to share it with whoever is participating in the pool. If they were kind of generating new addresses every time, it would be a mess. It would be difficult to demonstrate that what they say is actually true, right? So they try to be transparent and put everything into a, you know, easily trackable addresses. And then you can go through that and see all the transactions which relate to that address, right? Okay. There is one interesting one as a side comment. How are we doing with time? Yeah, it's fine. So I looked up yesterday a block which contains one transaction. So if a block contains one transaction, what does it mean? It actually contains no transactions, because it will only contain the default one reward transaction, right? So it means there is somebody mined a block which contains absolutely no transaction. They discovered the proper hash for it and they got reward for it, but they didn't include it, anybody's transaction in it, right? And they got 12.5 Bitcoin for doing that work. You see it clearly here. There is no fee because, you know, there are no other transactions than the one which collects the reward, right? Do you understand this? So why would a miner do that? So it's from F2Pool. If I open this, these guys and see their recent transactions, okay. Lots of transactions, lots of transactions, lots of transactions, and so on. And this one, no transactions. Again, lots, 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 lots. And this one, nothing, right? So if I check this block, it has, well, it has some transactions, but not much, not many. So why does it happen? That sometimes they have, so this block, one transaction. What do you think? Okay, so let's talk a little bit about mining. So we have those three stakeholders. We have the fully validating nodes, we have the miners, and we have users. Okay, if you are a user, you have some money. And you can buy something for that money. And it happens that you have this distributed, so you have this distributed database, right? So, which is the ledger. So it says who has currently how much money. Is this ledger consistent all the time? So if I say, does Bob has 100 units of account right now? What will I get as an answer? So me as a user, I ask the system a question saying, does Bob has 100 units of account right now in his account, in the ledger? What will be the answer? And by Bob, I mean I have his public key. I know it's Bob. He gave me his public key, right? So if I have a particular, a particular address, like the, so if we go to this address, and this address has currently 6,000 6,000 bitcoins with two confirmations. What does it mean? Okay, so let's think about it. This is a distributed system. Each node is connected to some other nodes. Each node has a copy of the database, but it's partially consistent. So some information is like from, if we look at the time, from time zero to now, the last block was generated, let's say, 3 minutes ago, right? So now is here. 3 minutes ago, there was last block generated, and then the previous one. The block contains all the transactions, which are stored in the database. At the last block, Bob had 100 units of account, right? But I'm not sure what will be in the next block, right? He might have just spent it right now. It goes like if this is Bob, he generated a transaction, he pushed it into something which is called mempool. So he says, please execute this transaction. The miners check the mempool, they pick some transactions to be included in the block. From the mempool. Once they find the particular nonce to hash the block, this transaction will be included and will be added to the chain. So when I'm asking, does Bob have 100 units? I will only get a probabilistic answer. I will get an answer that according to the last blocks he had it. And also it depends where he got it from, right? So like he has this public key associated with this 100 thing, and the input into that transaction happened sometime in the past. So it might happen just in the previous block, right? So we have this. We have the root node, root block. Then we have the next one, the next one. And then at some point, block is generated. Miner finds the block, advertises it to the fully validating network, and then they say, yeah, the block is valid. It gets added to the it gets added to the network. But while this is happening, another mining pool found out another block. And they advertise it to part of the network. The network has about 6,000 computers, so they kind of spread the information to some of the computers, and they spread the information around. But that takes some time, right? So that's why this 10 minutes block limit was invented, to allow the information to spread. So while this information is spreading, this information is also spreading. So at some point, some of the nodes see version A of the chain, and some blocks see version B. So if I ask a particular block, particular node, okay, does Bob has this amount? I may get one answer, but if I ask another, I can get another one, right? And then if the miners, because the blocks consists of the link to the previous block. So if the miners are now building the next part of the chain, some miners will be building here and some miners will be building here. So if the miners who were building here were faster, and then again the miners who built here were faster, what happens to that block, which was for a little while part of the chain, but then it was kind of orphaned. So all the transactions which are here are kind of not valid anymore, right? So that block is discarded. It's not part of the blockchain. So the blockchain settles for the longest path, which means transactions which are here are not valid anymore, which may happen that this input transaction, which gives Bob 100, was one of those. Therefore, when I'm asking, does Bob has 100, and that happened in the last block, and the answer is yes, but I ask about it, you know, a few blocks later, and the answer is no, right? So you have some temporal inconsistency. So how long does it last? Well, the kind of rule of thumb is 6 confirmations, which means about an hour, right? So if you have 6 blocks, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? If Bob was paid here, so the transaction which gave Bob 100 was 6 or earlier, I have more guarantee that it's actually not gonna swap under my feet. Question?
So confirmations that is blocks, how many blocks earlier?
Yes. So confirmations means how many blocks earlier that thing happened. All right, so now one more thing. The difficulty. So let me see here. Right, so we are at this block. We saw that it had one transaction and they got the money. So why would the miners do that? All right, so one theory might be, say, so I have miners and they just generated a block, right? So they generated a block, they advertise the block to the network, so they generate a particular block number, I don't know, block number 13, right? They advertise it to a network, and what they do immediately after? They immediately after start generating a new block, right? Because that would be the previous block. So then they start mining and start trying to find the hash for the new block. While they're doing it, the mempool might have been empty, right? They might not have been transactions. So that's why the transactions which are included in the block don't exist. But as we see from the recent history, the mempool is full. There is more transactions that can be incorporated. So that's not the case. So why would the miner mind just no transaction? Well, you know, what is mining? Well, so let's see. Right, so I will talk about it a little bit more. So the block consists of the version number of the protocol, the previous block hash, the Merkle tree of all the transactions. So the transactions are not really a list, it's a Merkle tree, the timestamp, the agreed difficulty, that the difficulty is kind of managed by the network. So a miner cannot mine something that is of less difficulty than whatever that requirement is. A transaction count, the transaction data, and announce. Announce is chosen by the miner. And the announce is chosen in such a way that this data structure hashes to a particular hash, right? So this hashes to a particular hash, and as you see here, whoops. And my browser crashed. How come? That's Yeah, so that works. So as you see, for this block, that's the hash of the block. And as you see, it has a nice number of zeros up front, right? So how likely is it that you hash something and you get a hash with so many zeros in front of it? Well, it's not very likely, right? I mean, if you just try manually to hash something to have hash with so many zeros in it, you will notice that it's futile. You will never get it if you do it manually, right? So that is the measure of difficulty. The difficulty basically says how many zeros the hash needs to have to be a valid hash for that particular block, for that particular difficulty. So we are trying to guess a hash by manipulating the nouns, because as you've seen, no, that's not this one. This one, yeah. So we kind of hashing this and trying to find a hash which has so many zeros up front to be a valid hash, and that takes time. That's why we kind of waiting roughly 10 minutes for each of the blocks. You have to be hashing the data structure. So if this data structure is larger, it takes a little bit more time because you have to be computing, you know, the hash on a slightly larger data structure. But it's not a big deal. It's just 1 megabyte, right? But nevertheless, it gives you a little bit of an edge. Like if you're doing it with that 1 megabyte less or with that 1 megabyte more, because you have to distribute it to all the pool people, and they have to be doing that. And sometimes what happens is the transactions in the mempool, so you have a number of transactions, right? They kind of happen, being posted, and some of them being revoked. So when the transaction is included into the block, then even if somebody revoked it, but a miner picked it up and mined it into a block, it will be in the block, right? It will be part of the chain. Sometimes some of the transactions turn up to be invalid. So let's say this happens. We kind of are mining. We have a block, which is the current block. Some other miners kind of did discovered a block, and we discovered a block, and then we have this, and somebody else has this, and now we're mining this block, right? In the mempool, we will have transactions which are from this era, and we have transactions which are from this era. So in mempool, if we're mining this one, we have to pick some transactions. Some will be safe, and some will not be safe, right? If we pick, and we root back to this one, if we pick transactions from here, we're consistent. But if we happen to pick a transaction which spends something from that transaction somewhere here, then by the definition of this block will be invalid. So, and then you have to do the analysis. You have to quickly know what is this chain like, what are those blocks, what transactions do they have, and then to be safe, right? So as a miner, sometimes the situation is so risky that you say, screw it, I don't know exactly which transactions from the mempool are safe to pick, because I can see that there is kind of a deeper and deeper hard fork happening. Therefore, I will just generate an empty one, and I will try. So, you know, they try to, so we have this kind of fork happening here. And now, if I generate an empty one, I'm strengthening that line, right? So then I will be more safe to get the reward from that one. Because for the miner, what happens is they have this 12.5 Bitcoin attached to the block. If they bet it on the wrong one, and this one is orphaned, all those rewards here are lost. You wasted time computing something and you haven't got the reward for it. So at some point, the risk might be too big to pick transactions to be included, and then you just don't, right? So if you see something like this, so typically it's an indication that there was something going on, and then it was kind of risky to pick transactions from the mempool, so they didn't pick any, generated the next block to strengthen the particular line of what they were working for, and then kind of make it stronger. And then at the end of the day, one of those tips will fail, right? So the longest one, the strongest one always wins, and this one is distracted, and then you end up with the blockchain, right? Not a block tree. Okay, so what is a Merkle tree? That's an easy one. You know what hash is. You know what tree is. So what is a Merkle tree? It's like tree of hashes, basically, right? So let's say I have a tree. I have some sort of a data. I have another data. Another data, and I have right. So I have a data structure which is a tree. Okay, so I have some transactions here. Let's say all those data are transactions data. Okay, so now how do I make sure, and this is a list of transactions in each of those things, how do I make sure that they are all valid? Yeah, I need confirmations, but I also need hashes to verify that the transaction haven't been tampered with, right? So if I want to make sure that the data hasn't been tampered with, I have to attach hashing, right? So I attach a hash. So each transaction has a signature, and then I can hash the whole list of transactions into a hash. So I have kind of a hash attached to each of those. And then I have a hash attached to that, but I can hash my children as a separate hash, right? So I hash my children as a separate hash, and I hash my children as a separate hash, and then I have the hashes for my transactions. So then I have, so here I have a hash of this hash and this hash at the root, right? So now if I give someone that hash, they can verify that nothing in this data structure has changed, right? So if I tell them, here is like, you know, a million transactions, I can give you just one hash, and then you can verify all those million transactions to make sure that however you calculate all those hashes, hash to that single hash, and that's correct, right? So that's kind of an efficient way of verifying or confirming kind of a complex data structure, which is basically a tree of hashes. So a Merkle tree is a tree of hashes, where the hash of a parent is basically a hash of children, right? So what is DAG? Do you know DAG? So let's Google it. DAG, computer science. Wikipedia is your friend. Directed acyclic graph. So what is a directed acyclic graph? Well, we discussed the blockchain, and we discussed the transactions. So transactions are, you have the address and you have the input and you have the unspent output of a particular address, and then you have the outputs, right? So we said, well, they kind of do like this, some loop back, some go somewhere, and some go back, right? So you have transactions which are not you have a graph which is with cycles, and analyzing that graph. So if I say, can this particular public address spend, so what is the unspent output of that particular public address? If I have cycles and I have this very complex transaction graph with cycles, it's super hard for me to answer that question, right? I need to convert it into a data structure which I can search through and calculate what is currently the unspent output of that address. So if we go back to one of the addresses, you know, they have 1,200 transactions in it. Input flowing is 1600, output flowing is this. I have to make sure that I can calculate that. And how can I calculate that? By traversing the entire history of blockchain from the day zero to current block and analyzing that graph, right? Because that's super hard. What we do is we convert it into a DAG instead. So we have a data structure which allows us to kind of do this. So we have the cycles, but if we have something kind of that loops back here, we have to convert it into a different arrangement in such a way that we keep track of the transfers, and we know that some money, some unspent output is still in this transaction, but that one has the value which hasn't been kind of really transferred there, right? So we kind of shortcut it. So if I have some value traveling here and some value traveling there and some value coming back, I can kind of shortcut it and remove that the cycle and keep the value here to be able to traverse that. So I convert the original data structure, which is really difficult to search and really difficult to answer those questions, into this data structure, which is much easier to search and get answers to of what the current unspent output is, right? So again, if you are into digital forensics and if you need to analyze the transaction graphs of the chains, you typically spend time generating the DAG first. It's time consuming because you have to analyze the entire cyclic graph first and generate the equivalent data structure. But once you have it, once you have the DAG, then you can answer the queries in a much faster way. So this is that's what DAG is used for. And that's most systems kind of are generated and use it. All right, so we have we talked about the mining. We talked about the difficulty, that is the number of zeros in the hash, basically. We talked a little bit about the self-regulating nature of the Bitcoin blockchain, that on average, the blocks should be generated every 10 minutes. And then you have the reward. So we talked back and forth about those three stakeholders. So one one stakeholder are miners, then you have users, and then you have the fully validating nodes. So we talked about the users, and we talked about the possibility of forks kind of forming temporarily in the chain. And we talked about the nature of this question of saying how much money Bob has, that it's a bit probabilistic, right? So if you want to have a guarantee, you have to wait for enough confirmations to have the transaction buried long enough in the chain that it's kind of, you are certain that the transactions which gave you the funds, so if I have a transaction somewhere in this block and they are giving me some bitcoins, then I know that, you know, they're not gonna disappear because they kind of have been confirmed long enough ago that it's very unlikely that that history is gonna be rewritten. But what happens kind of relatively here is a little bit unstable, right? So what can happen is Bob generated a transaction and he said, I'm gonna send one Bitcoin to Mariusz, right? So he sends one Bitcoin to me. And that transaction gets embedded in one of the blocks. But he can also say, and he's doing that from unspent output of one of his addresses that he owns. So he generated the transaction which spends it, and he generated another transaction which uses the same address. So he's so-called doing double spend, right? He's trying to spend money twice, right? So as a user, you can try to do double spend. Okay? As a miner, what can you do? You can only generate blocks, empty blocks, right? What would happen if a miner is generating empty blocks all the time? Well, it's problematic, right? So here we have a double spend problem. Here we have miners doing something not right. Or what if the miner generates a block which gives them the reward, but the difficulty is not right? Right, so they just generated a random hash very quickly, gave themselves a reward, and tried to get that block included into the chain. So block is invalid. Okay. What if the miners say, let's say that there are transactions in the mempool, right? And the miners can generate empty blocks, okay, but they can also say all the transactions from a particular address, we know the address is Mariusz's address. We're never gonna include any of those into the blocks. We just do that, right? If you want, Mariusz, if you want your transactions to be included, you have to pay us, right? So they do some selective transaction picking, right? Can they do that? They can. So there is a number of things miners can do wrong. There are some things users can do wrong. And what if you have a network with some fully validating nodes saying, oh, look, this block is valid, but actually it isn't. And it kind of gives them some reward or something, or they make transactions which never happened or whatever, right? So some of the nodes, do, let's say they try to cheat, right? So some of the nodes of the network try to cheat. So you have this kind of a triple. You have users which may do something wrong. You have miners which might do something wrong. And you have the fully validating nodes which can do something wrong. So how does it work? Well, the double spend is partially managed by the miners and managed by the mempool, which is the fully validating nodes. So if there are two conflicting transactions
trying to spend the same unspent output, the fully validating node which currently sees the mempool will reject it. Will say no, that transaction is double spent. We not want that, right? So honest fully validating node will not accept it. And of course the mempool lives in the distributed way, in the distributed network. So the miners also check, they generate the DAG and so on, and they check to include the transactions which don't double spend the spend output as well, right? So if I have a chain and some of the transactions are already spent, then if I'm working on a next block, I'm not gonna pick transactions from the mempool which double spend something as a miner, right? So honest miners prevent that as well. Okay, so we have these two controlling the users. We have the fully validating nodes controlling the miners, because everything miners do, the network needs to accept, right? So the network of fully validating nodes has to check, yeah, the difficulty of that block is valid, everything is valid, and you follow the protocol. So they validate the transactions and they validate the blocks. And then who verifies this? So these two moderate users, these guys moderate miners. Who moderates the fully validating nodes? Nobody, right? That's the kind of ultimate network. And what validates them is majority. So honest majority. If the majority is dishonest, the system collapses, right? So if the majority of validating nodes behaves in a dishonest way, the network doesn't function properly. There is no other control mechanism. The only control mechanism is that the fully validating nodes usually have a stake in the process, right? So they have some form of financial or, you know, ideological interest. And users are kind of commercial users, but also the developers. It's kind of a category which provides software for miners and for a fully validating node. So those are the maintainers of the protocol and so on. So they kind of provide the evolution of the state of the system. So here we have something which is called 51% attack, right? So theoretically, if 51% of the nodes are not behaving the way they should, the network will start accepting things which shouldn't be accepted, because majority accepts some of the things, right? So here we have, you know, 49% says this block is invalid, you should do this one, but if 51% says this one is valid, then this one will keep growing and will become a dominant chain, and that will become an orphan. So if that happens, what will happen? So let's say there is a possibility that 51% attack happened. 51% of the network, let's say we have the fully validating nodes being inflicted with some authoritarian regime or something, right? So we have some of the blocks which are clearly, so those are valid, but only 49% of the network claims those are valid. 51% claims those are valid, but these guys said no, those are invalid. That the whole chain here is invalid. So these guys keep voting on blocks here, right? So you have the split, and you have so-called fork, right? So now, depending on the decision of the miners who generate the blocks, the split will either continue to grow or will disappear, right? If the majority of the miners are corrupt and they have vested financial interest and they drop support for the legitimate chain, that will die and this will keep growing. But if half of the, or you know, 49% of the miners go here and 51 go here, then you will have a permanent fork, right? We didn't have a permanent fork in Bitcoin since the beginning. There is a strong debate currently about doing that. It may happen. There was a permanent fork in Ethereum. So last year, there was a situation where there was a bug in the software and the community split. Part of the community went with the... so normally, there was a bug. And they fixed the bug, but the fix of the bug meant reverting back the history and starting a fork in the Ariel block, right? So what happened was like this. It was kind of like a, an interesting phenomenon where you had the normal blocks like this, and there was a discovery that there was a bug. And part of the community said, well, you know, there is a bug, so let's fix it and let's continue the way it is now, because by the very nature of the blockchain, spirit, it's irreversible. You should never reverse something that happened in the past, right? So there was kind of a, let's say, ideology was that this should continue. But because of the bug, here there was a certain attack which stole funds from legitimate users, right? So this block contains the kind of tinted data. I mean, it wasn't the fault of the users, it was the fault of the software. So the consortium decided, okay, what we will do a hard fork from the earlier block and we will rewrite the history. And we will kind of have a split. So this will become the proper blockchain. And the one which is tinted with the transactions which are due to the fault will be discarded. But part of the community disagree with that decision of that, that this should be an orphan and that should be the new legitimate one based on the claim that, you know, you shouldn't rewrite the history, right? So now we have two. We have two Ethereum chains, one which is the kind of the main one, and one which is kind of the main one, which used to be the main one, right? Yeah, so with Bitcoin we will see. It's an interesting space to look at. All right, so we went a little bit over an hour. Let's finish this. So in Bitcoin, blocks are generated every 10 minutes, so roughly 6 blocks per hour. Every 2016 blocks, the difficulty is recalculated to, because if there are more hashing power, then the blocks are generated faster than every 10 minutes, right? That's clear. So every now and then, the speed is recalculated and the difficulty is adjusted, and it keeps like that for 2 weeks. And then when the hashing power drops or rises, the difficulty is adjusted. So typically it goes up because more people mine. And then every 200,010 blocks, the BTC reward halves. So it started with 50 bitcoins when it started in 2009. So if you mined a block, and you could mine back then on a normal PC, you could find the blocks yourself running the client, you would get 50 bitcoins. And then in November 2012, it halved to 25. And then last year we had this big event where nothing happened and it halved to 12.5, right? In July. And as you see it roughly every 4 years. So from 2009 to 2012, from 2012 to 2016, and now in 2020, roughly in June, maybe July, we'll see the next halving from 12.5 to 6.25, right?
We talked about the Merkle tree and the length of the chain. We talked about the transaction header, and we looked at the transactions. Here is another one. So I drew some pictures here, but that's kind of a good explanation of the origin and the two outputs, right? So there is a 4.3 bitcoins in this address, and there are two transactions. So there is a 0.9 going to this address and 3.33 going to this address, right? So if I check check this transaction, you will see that. So if you calculate it, if you add those two numbers, you will see that there is 0.08 missing, right? That's what we were discussing, that not everything is spent. If it was zero here, what would happen? The transaction wouldn't end up in the mempool. So if somebody advertises a transaction and the validating node sees no fee, it just rejects it. It doesn't get to the mempool, and it doesn't get to be included into the blocks. So you can see that the transaction is quite small. It has one unspent output from a previous transaction. So that's what that output means. We have 4.33 to spend, and then we have to spend the whole thing. So which means we're spending 0.99 and 3.33, and then 0.008 is left, and that gets to a miner who mined the block which contains that transaction, right? And you can see which block contains that transaction by using the block index here, right?
You said that the transactions with fees as zero value fees.
Yeah.
Dropped,
yeah.
By the fully validated node.
Yeah.
But they still get mined.
So they could get mined. So it's up to the miners. So in the earlier on, that wasn't the restriction. Actually, the transactions in the fully validating nodes, that they were accepting transactions with no fees. And then the miners were deciding to include them or not into the blocks. But at some point in the past, miners stopped including them into the blocks. So the mempool was growing with all those transactions which didn't have any fees, because miners were just not using them to be included in the blocks. So the clients were modified in such a way that if somebody advertises a transaction to a node and that transaction doesn't have a fee, that transaction is dropped. So most fully validating nodes now drop transactions with no fees. You can modify your client, and you can have a client because, you know, it's a network, right? So it's about 6,000 computers. And yours is one of them. You can say, I have 30 computers. So you will have, you know, 30 computers which run your software. And your software may accept the empty fee transactions, right? So you have a subspace of the whole network where if the transaction has no fee, you say it's a valid one. So in your mempool, you include it, right? You can have a miner which checks mempools from different nodes. And some of them might be from your network. And then those transactions are in, but the miner decides if it will pick it or not. So if a miner is not in your control, most miners don't. They don't accept, they don't pick transactions with zero fees. You may have, in addition to your 30 validating nodes, you can have your own miner. And you can mine those transactions and advertise them. And those are valid. So if you have a block where you included some transactions with zero fees, fully validating nodes don't care anymore. So they will validate your transaction block, and they will say, yeah, that's a valid block. As a side effect, it does contain some transactions with zero fees, but, you know, at that point, who cares? It was your wasted energy or whatever you've used to mine them. And you can do that, right? So you can. So if you are a miner and you have some, like you have to distribute the funds that you have to the pool. of course you're gonna do transactions with no fees because you're the miner, you decide, right? And you know, it doesn't matter because if you include fees, they go back to you anyway, right? So you don't, right? So you will have blocks with transactions with zero fees, and those are typically the spending transactions of the miners themselves. They don't pay fees, right? All right, so let's have another short break, and then we will talk a little bit more about the internals of the Bitcoin. I have a couple of more slides about the technical details of the Bitcoin. And then we can talk a little bit more general about blockchains before we talk about Ethereum. So we talked already about the three stakeholders. We talked about the transactions and how they kind of work in terms of unspent outputs and inputs and outputs, but to have it actually work, you have to have the way to verify it, right? So the ledger is kind of like a static data structure, but to have the verification being done, you have to do a little bit of computations. And to do those computations, we have kind of like a mini language, mini assembly language inside Bitcoin to run those verification checks. It's oriented towards doing crypto operations. It's a little bit boring, but it's not too difficult to kind of understand of what is happening. So it's called Bitcoin script, basically. So it is kind of like a computing language, which allows you to write small scripts which are attached on the input and outputs of the transaction to make the verification happen. It is forth-like. Do you know programming language forth? It's one of the very early programming languages in around 2000, mid-2010s, like, I don't remember, maybe 2008 or something, there was a bit of a revival because there was a new programming language called Factor. So if you Google Factor programming language, you will get kind of a modern implementation of forth and some of the paradigms which are kind of coming with it. Forth is interesting because it's a stack-based programming language which uses kind of a reverse Polish notation to pass arguments. So normally when you have like C-like language, you say add and then you pass arguments like 1, 2, right? So you say add those two numbers. And then the result is 3, right? In forth, you would say 2, 1, add, right? So you will push 2 on the stack, push 1 on the stack, and then call add, which pops 2 things from the stack and pushes the result, right? So if I execute this program, and this is my stack, I would have 2, 1, and then add happens, add pops 2 things from the stack and pushes the result. So I will end up with this. So the interesting thing here is that, as you see, the operations have no arguments in a sense. They pop arguments from the stack. Whereas here, my function has some arguments which I have to pass to the function, right? So the binding of arguments to functions is more dynamic with stack-based language because it will just take whatever is there on the stack. It has a number of opcodes which it uses and it's Turing incomplete. What does it mean? So what does it mean that something is Turing incomplete? That I have a machine or language or a computer which cannot do Turing complete computations, yeah?
More or less that you cannot map every operation using that language or using that script language, for example.
Yeah. Again, it's a bit of a simplification. We will not go into a theory of computability, but if you say take a language like C or Java or C++, they are Turing complete. You can express kind of everything you can express in a programming language which is Turing complete. So Turing incomplete means you can express some things, but some things you can't, right? So what is one of the and in fact, on a normal computer, if I have a normal computer with one of those languages, I am not quite Turing complete neither. But if I have a computer which is attached to a network, so if I have a network and a cloud behind it, I can kind of approximate that, yes, I can, with those two languages and those resources, I'm Turing complete. Right, so one of the things that that Bitcoin script doesn't have is loops. You cannot iterate and doesn't have loops. So that makes it Turing incomplete just because of that. So you have a bonus question. What are the necessary instructions to enable Turing complete computing? Again, it's a little bit side question, but so if I have, let's say Java and C, right? So I have kind of a high level concepts. I map it to some sort of virtual machine. And this virtual machine has an instruction set. So I have an instruction set. So with Java, let's pick Java. So my high level language is Java. The VM is the Java VM. The Java VM is using, so JVM. The JVM is using bytecodes which are compiled from the Java source. And then the bytecode is just in time compiled to the machine code, right? And the machine code is executed on the particular instruction set of a particular CPU architecture. So let's take x86 as an example. And then with x86, I have, you know, move instruction, jump, some arithmetics like add, and some conditionals like, you know, compare. So those are my assembly instructions, pretty much, which I'm doing. And those mean doing Turing complete computing just with those instructions. So the question is, what are the necessary instructions to enable? So necessary instruction is the memory operation, some form of arithmetic. Addition would do, probably. You can just having increment, you can probably do everything else. Logical operation and the jump instruction, right? Jump. So what is the minimum set? How many instructions do I have to have in my VM to have a Turing complete? So here we listed like 4 or 5 instructions. How many do you think we need? In the language you have much more, right? So that, you know, here you have lots of different functions and so on. But it boils down to those, say, 5. But in fact, you can have a Turing complete VM, which is just one instruction. Okay? I will let you think about it a little bit. It's a kind of a weird instruction, but it's only one. So you can express all possible programs written in Java in just one instruction on a VM level. All right. Let's look at that transaction again. So we had the blocks, Bitcoin address. Where did we have the transaction? Uh, Let me just find it, because that one was nice because it only had two outputs. All right, so we see here that we have input address. I mean, that's our place where we're getting the funds from, so that's what we're spending. And the output is 433. I showed you the chart, so you see the single address spending money to two addresses with the 0.08 fee. And what you can have here is also, it says height script Coinbase. So if we scroll down, we see this. We see an input script, which is just two things. So one and two, this is like a first argument and the second argument. And we have the output script, which is opdup, ophash 160, a value, op equal verify, and opchecksig. You can read it? Yeah. So what does it mean? What is this and what is this? Well, it kind of turns out it's cool, it's good to have something that, so if I look at it, I have my I have my unspent output, and that becomes the input to another. So here is I have one address, I have another address, and then this input can be spent. So let's say Mariusz is here. I own the private key to this. Bob is here. Bob owns the private key to this. So now I'm doing something which passes funds to Bob, and then Bob can do something to spend it, right? So I have to lock it. And then when Bob wants to spend it, he needs to unlock it, right? So we have kind of two parts of the script. One is to kind of lock the spending. The other one is to unlock. And for my transaction, so I'm kind of passing the transaction to Bob, right? So what happens is I have some lock on my transaction, whoever passed me the funds. And now I want to send them to Bob, so I have to unlock it, right? And the way it is done by a very simple script. So when we were discussing the reverse Polish notation, so we pass arguments first, and then we pass the operation, right? So that's our program. That's how forth look like. And we see here that we have two parts. So up to here, that part is the lock script. The first part is the lock script, and it's this. Just a signature and a public key, okay? What does it mean? Well, it means that whoever passed me the funds put their signature and my public key as the two arguments, okay? So my public key is this, is the address. Their signature, how did they calculate the signature? For the unspent output of wherever I'm getting the funds, how did they calculate that? So what did they use to generate that signature? They use the private key of the public key of that address, right? So you have the public key is here. They use the private one to generate that signature. So now if I need to spend it, I can verify that that signature holds. Otherwise, people would be able to spend money for somebody else without knowing their private key, right? So that signature is this ownership check that they owned that thing, right? So they gave me the money, and I can see that they owned the money because they have put the signature as the lock script part. So now I can verify that this signature is valid with that public key because I can verify that they have the private key for that. Does it make sense? Okay, so this is what they gave me, and that's the sig lock, right? So that's the first script sig. It's the first part for their input. And then that part is my script pub key sequence, right? And what I do there? Well, I basically put my address. So I'm using public key hash of that public key. I'm duplicating, so it's pretty simple. If you read it from left to right and you follow the stack-based management. So first the signature gets on the stack. So I have a stack. And first, the signature goes on the stack. Second, public key goes onto the stack. And then dupe happens. Dupe duplicates the top element of the stack. So I have now two public keys here, right? And then hash 160 happens. That's the RIPE-MD algorithm, which hashes that public key to the 160-bit hash value. So now it consumed that and generated the hash 160, right? So we are here, and then this happens. So this is, if we go back here, we see this is the argument, right? That's the argument of Bob's address. No, it's not. It's the public key of. It's the hash of the public key which signing sig was using, right? So signing sig was using this public key, and now I calculated the hash, and here I have the same hash in plain text. I just have it as an argument. And then I run equal verify. So I'm checking, are those two things on the stack the same? And they have to match, right? By the nature of the check. So if they match, those two things are consumed, and I validated that I passed that correct thing here. And then once I did that operation, the last operation left is this one. And this one checks that those two things kind of are correct, right? So now I've checked this is correct. I pass the public key hash and I unlock the spending. So I can basically, I transfer the fund from one address to another. So the question here is, so first question is, what would happen if the Turing script, if the Bitcoin scripts were Turing complete? What could happen? We have to be doing that all the time. All the validating nodes and all your software has to be confirming that the transactions are valid. So you have to be executing those scripts millions and millions of times, right? So if those scripts were Turing complete and had loops, it could be that they take long time to be executed, right? So someone can write a malicious script which just loops infinitely. And then your software would get stuck. So you start verifying something and then it never ends, right? So that's the main reason why we don't have Turing completeness, to make it efficient and non-easily corruptible. Okay, so we did, we passed in here, we passed the public key hash instead of passing the public key and comparing the public key directly, right? So we could do this instead of doing all of that, and it would still sort of check that the spending was correct. But if we did that, what would be the disadvantage? It's much faster, but we would have to pass everything by the long public keys instead of passing things by the 160-bit hashes. So as you've seen here, oops, that's not a fair comparison, because that the first one is actually a signature. So the signature is pretty long, and then the address is that 160 ripe MD one. So passing those things as confirmation of something, or as for verification, is much better than passing the long ones. So it actually started, people were using initially, they were using scripts which were doing this directly, but later on they kind of settled that passing hash 60 instead of the full keys was a better way of achieving the same thing. All right, so a little bit of a humor. As I said, we didn't go full on the onto the theory of computation. So here, you know, a professor is describing non-deterministic Turing machines, and that runs in some polynomial time. We can devise an algorithm that takes an input of length n and produces e of m and w. The running time is certain O complexity on a multi-tape deterministic Turing machine, and so on. So, you know, Turing machines are kind of interesting. Non-deterministic Turing machines are interesting. Oracles are interesting. So those things are kind of fundamental to the theory of computing. But, you know, we don't really have to dive into the details here. We have, so that concludes the Bitcoin part. There are some references. There is a description of the script with all the instructions that are being used, some papers about blind signatures, and references to the tools that we've used for browsing the blocks. So I have two more things, but we kind of are a little bit time constrained, so I prepared too much stuff to present in 4 hours, so we will skip some things. So I will play you that short video to introduce you to IPFS. How many of you know IPFS? Okay. How many of you know Git? What Git is? So how Git works? Very quickly. So I have a file, and I did some modifications. So I have modifications, and I modified it to a new version of the file. Right. So let's say I have a file with A, and now I have a file with AB. So what Git stores? Git stores the differences, the change sets. Right? So this is important. The diff between those two. So the fact that B was added.
right? So now this change set points to the original. And then if I have another modification, I say I've added a C. So now I have a change set where C was added, and that points to the previous one, and that points to this one, right? What Git uses to do those change sets? What Git uses? Have you heard about this one? After Google revealed that SHA-1 collisions will happen, suddenly everybody was talking about Git repositories being unsafe and, you know, people being able to sneak in some malicious software into repositories. That's because of that, because we do calculate those change sets using that hashing. So we attach hashes to everything, right? If we attach hashes to everything and we have, so this is my documents. So A, B, C, but those are the change set and the initial one is empty, right? So it's like no change and we have hashes. How does it look like? It kind of looks like a blockchain, right? It looks like a chain of blocks where the later one points to the previous one and to the previous one. So to reconstruct the document, you kind of have to go from the tip backwards to be able to tell what the document looks like right now, right? With other version control systems, we were keeping the history of the documents and we're keeping the, you start here and you can go back to see what the document looked in the previous version, or you can start here and see how the document evolved. But in Git, you only can start from the back and go change sets to the front to see what the history look like. So that is kind of interesting. And we're using hash functions to do content-based addressing. So like what will happen in Git if I say I have document A, I've added B, I deleted B. What will happen? So I have the original change set, which says A. Then I've added a new, which added B, which points to the previous one. And then I deleted B. Then what happens? Nothing happens. The head is moved from pointing to here to pointing to here. Right? Git says, yeah, that's the latest version of the document. You know, and then sometimes what happens is somebody else in another branch adds B again, and then Git will recognize it because the hash is hashed to the same content. It doesn't matter when or who did something. What matters is if the change looks exactly the same, right? All right, so IPFS is kind of a similar idea, but for the web, to replace HTTP, right? So the same way as Git replaced other kind of a versioning systems. IPFS is kind of a metaphor for saying web is broken because we address stuff by IP addresses and then we get the content. But how about we hash the content and address the content by the hash, right? So currently, if you want to have a Facebook page rendered on your browser, what do? You say facebook.com, right? What if you want a Microsoft web page to be rendered? You say Microsoft.com, right? So you use IP address to get, so there is a certain content sitting somewhere in the web, right? So you have millions of nodes in the web, millions of computers all around, and you say, and you are here with your computer, and you say, I want to render a particular content, right? And you're addressing it by the IP address. With BitTorrent, how do you do that? Do you say, I want this content from that node? No, you say, I want this content by this hash. and then these guys, these nodes say, yeah, yeah, I have it, I have it, I have it, and they, and then you swarm, right? Why not to use it for browsing web pages, right? So if you have some particular HTML page, you hash it, and then it's in one of the nodes or in two of the nodes, and then you say, I want this particular hash, then it doesn't matter if it comes from this IP address or from this. It's the same thing, right? So you say, I want this. Then this guy says, yeah, we have it. So then you can get it from one of those two things. And then you as a node also have that content now. So if your friend wants to watch the same movie you just watched, instead of them downloading it from US, they can download it using LAN from you because you just watched the same movie or watched the same picture or rendered the same web page, right? And you kind of address it by the same hash. So yeah, I will not play the video. It's a short video. You can Google it as well. The idea here is that you have a file system, which has certain properties. So it's a kind of a global file system. It looks kind of like a Google Drive or Dropbox. It's distributed among all the peers, and it is content addressable. So if you need a particular content, if you need a particular page or file or executable or Android APK or whatever, you address it by the hash of that content, and then whoever has it, you can get it. And once you get it, you kind of cache it locally. So you kind of have it cached locally. So if you unplug from the network, you still have it. And then because you're part of the network, others can get it from you if they are nearby. So the algorithm tries to optimize from where it works. Why are we talking about it? Well, we're talking about it because inside the blockchain, you basically can store hashes, but nothing else, right? You can store a little bit of data using the script. So there is a little bit of space for you to put something like, 160 characters encoded of some sort, but you cannot put a movie on it or a file or document, right? So if in the blockchain you can only store hashes and you have a file system which is hash addressable, then you have a perfect match, right? So that's why I kind of bring up IPFS, because in many projects IPFS complements some sort of a blockchain deployment. All right, so that's one part. The other part is Ethereum, but yeah, let's start. I will not go into all the technical details. I will just give you kind of a taste. So blockchain solved the data consistency problem. It kind of makes it that you have an agreement among all the peers, even though you don't trust any of them, assuming majority is honest, right? That's the only assumption. You don't need everybody to be honest. You just want 51% to be honest, and the system will work. And if majority is not honest, the honest minority will discover it and there will be a split. So it cannot be silent, right? So if there is something happening in the blockchain which a minority disagrees with, the minority will kind of influence the rest in a sense of making it visible, right? So it's not possible that they are 51% attacks right now on Bitcoin, because we would see it, right? We haven't seen that. So that means they have none happened yet. Once they happen, we will see them, right? It uses cryptography. The global state is stored in the network, is distributed. So in a sense, you cannot really take it down, right? To take down Bitcoin, you would have to take down every single node. If there is a single node still working and mining and work, you know, continuing the chain, then the system continues. Right, you have to take everybody down. So it's the same with IPFS. To take the IPFS down, you have to take all the nodes down. Because as long as there is one which still runs, they still have a copy of data and so on and so forth. Which leads to some interesting problems. So for example, imagine that you have an IPFS setup. So let's say IPFS ready to go off and everybody's running it and blah, blah, blah. And you have kind of a Norway, and you are hosting some content on your node in Norway, and that content is deemed deemed illegal in some jurisdiction, right? So let's say you have a map of let's not go into details. Like, you have some illegal content which some of the country says is illegal, right? There is technically no way for them forcing you to remove it because they are outside of your jurisdiction. And also for their nodes, they, because it's part of the network, that content is available to everybody, right? So how can you make it such that you remove illegal content? It's an unsolved problem, right? Because here everything is kind of transparent, but it's not removable in a sense, right? You would have to go to each individual node which has the copy and force them to remove the content, which might not be feasible. And then other interesting thing is that blockchains have an internal clock. So we were discussing it with the confirmations and saying something which was in the past is more secure than something that is very recent because we have more stability in it. So they kind of have an internal clock ticking. So some blockchain examples, Bitcoin, of course, we discussed that. There are others. So Dashcoin, have you heard about this? Dashcoin is, it has interesting properties. So from the forensics point of view, it's much more interesting than Bitcoin, actually, because it started off as a more anonymity conscious equivalent of a Bitcoin. And it provides some interesting mechanisms for controlling the of how the distribution of power happens. So in Bitcoin, we have those three stakeholders, right? Miners, validating nodes, and the users. And Dashcoin is the same. Plus, you have two tiers. So instead of all the miners and all the validating nodes being flat, so they have the same rights, you have a selected number of nodes, let's say 4,000 of those, which are limited. So let's say it's limited only to 4,000 nodes. And each node has, let's say, 1,000 bitcoins or Dashcoin equivalent of stake being put into the node to become that second tier, right? So I have the normal tier one, and the second one is this, right? I have tier two, which has those properties, right? What does it mean? Well, it means that, you know, let's say you are NSA and you want to infiltrate and analyze the traffic which happens in the network. You, like with Tor or with Bitcoin, you just inject some of the nodes, validating nodes, to observe who is connected with whom and how it goes, right? But you cannot do that with Dash, because here you would have to inject a number of nodes, each of which costs you a lot of money. And also the number is limited, so you'd have to make sure that those are kind of replaced, right? So historically, those nodes are kind of run by trusted people, and it's really hard to infiltrate the network from the outside. You kind of get it? Yeah. So now let's say a transaction comes in, we have transaction pool, and then one of the trusted nodes can immediately approve it, because they have a stake, they have this kind of a Dash deposit somewhere. If they do something illegal, they will be kicked out and they will lose the deposit. So it kind of goes, it's not really, but it kind of reflects a little bit of a proof of work, which is the normal way of making sure that miners don't cheat, and the proof of stake, right? Proof of stake is a mechanism where instead of betting with our resources and computing power, we actually betting with some money, right? We say, I bet that this block which I just generated is correct. If it's proven wrong, I lose the deposit, right? So if you have miners saying, this block is valid, please accept it, and here is 100 bitcoins. If this block turns out to be invalid, I'm losing 100 bitcoins, right? Then instead of waiting 10 minutes and burning electricity, you'd be kind of betting on the stake. Okay, then we have Zcash.
So Zcash is very interesting because it improves the anonymity of the transactions and the people who are participating. So as we've seen with Bitcoin, everything is transparent and everything is visible through the public keys. So you can keep track of public keys, right? So if I tell you, if I send you money, you will know my public key of one of the transactions that I've made. And then you can backtrack who was sending me money and where I was sending money from. And you can build a graph and understand of where my assets are and who I am dealing with. So if I'm, yep. No. So, yeah, so it works like this. You have, so someone sends you funds, right? So now you have funds in particular address. You generated a fresh address, but then you generate another fresh address. But then, you know, it's a chain, right? So you have to pay someone and put the change somewhere. And it's still a chain, it's still traceable, right? So if this is a honeypot of whatever, then they will track down, okay, it leads to you, right? You have to use some sort of mixing service, or you have to combine some transactions in such a way that is difficult to track back. So, for example, generating fresh addresses doesn't really help, but what you can do is you can do this. And that's what Dash was also doing, is you can have an address to where everybody sends money to, right? So let's say, 20 people send money to that address, right? And now you generated 20 fresh addresses. And then you distributed those money to those 20 fresh addresses, right? So now, let's say someone knew that you are this guy. They knew your address here. You've sent money here, and then they kind of know that you're one of those 20, but they don't know which one, right? But you have to do it in a smart way, because if you do it in a dumb way, then if the values which are attached to those transactions coming in are different than the ones coming out, you can still do some analytics on it, right? So if this guy sent 10, this guy sent 20, this guy sent 30, and you sent one, and one of those addresses is, 10, roughly 10, 20, 30, and one, it's like, it's easy to guess you are this guy, right? And there are algorithms which are doing that and doing plus minus some fee which the service takes and try to estimate what is the probability that you and you are the same guy, right? And detecting those mixing services is quite easy because you see the behavior of what happens through them. So there are some tools and some analytics which do that. So in general, in Bitcoin, you cannot really be anonymous. Even if you're generating fresh addresses, and even if you're using some of the mixing services, so you will still be somewhat tracked. But with Zcash, you can't. It's cryptographically impossible to track back the transactions. So that's much more interesting from the privacy point of view. And there are other ones. There is Monero, there is Nav, Cloak. There are a number of coins which are using the anonymity preserving features. There's also term which I missed. Fungible. What does that mean? So if I have $1 on my Visa, is it fungible? So fungible means kind of indistinguishable. You can freely substitute one with the other and you cannot see the difference, right? So if I have $1 on my Visa, from one hand, of course, it's fungible because $1 is equal to any other $1, right? I mean, if I can buy something for $1, it doesn't matter if it's from my Visa or from your Visa. But so from the value point of view, those are fungible. But from the actual like property point of view, they are not, because my US dollar or my Visa is mine and your one is yours. So the tax office can distinguish that dollar being mine or yours, right? So
in some situations that either helps or disrupts the anonymity preservation. So in Bitcoin, if there is an address and there is a value, let's say one Bitcoin attached to that address, you know, and you have another address and one Bitcoin attached to that one, of course they are, the value, face value is the same, but they are not fungible, right? So if this transfers the $1 here and this transfers $1 here, I mean the one Bitcoin, they are kind of two different ones. And then if they both transfer the value to this one, then this one will have two. And then the fungibility property is kind of improved, because if this one spends 0.5 and loops back 1.5, then you cannot really tell, was it this one spent or was it this one spent? Because they kind of joined, right? So the value suddenly is kind of combined. So Bitcoin is not fully fungible, but it has fungibility property if you do it using the kind of a join transactions. So if you join the transactions, then in the place where they join, the information which was used to distinguish them is lost, right? So now that information is partially lost. And then the final one is Ethereum. So Ethereum is very interesting, because the basic idea is Bitcoin is great, but how about having Turing completeness? Wow, that's really difficult, right? Because we just discussed, what about the loops? What about this and that? It's like really hard to make a Turing complete script inside the blockchain. So how did they do that? Well, I don't have it here. So I have it here. So we basically have to have a mechanism to prevent infinite loops. How would you prevent infinite loops? Well, it's a simple idea. So, you know, how Amazon prevents people doing something infinitely expensive on their platform. They charge people, right? So there is a cost associated of running an instance. And there is also cost associated with storing something on Amazon. So Ethereum has a programming language, which is sort of like a JavaScript, which is object-oriented, and it allows you to do Turing complete programs. You can do anything you want, but you pay per instruction of what you're executing, and you pay per byte of storage that you're using. And those fees go to the person who validates the blocks, right? It's sort of like a minor fees. So they solve the Turing completeness problem of having abuse of the network by introducing economical incentives. So you basically have to pay for the contracts that you're running, right? Okay. So why would you need that? Why would this be useful? Well, it sort of solves the trusted third party problem. So let's say we want to play rock paper scissors, right? So we can play right now asynchronously, right? So we play and one of us wins, and we see it because we play synchronously, right?
Can you do this over a telephone? No, not really, because you have to synchronize over a telephone, and it's much harder than synchronize like with visual cues, right? So the atomicity of the rock paper over telephone is really hard to achieve. So how could you play it asynchronously over internet, like through some software, some agents kind of roam around and they want to do that? Yeah, it's hard. So, you know, you use a trusted third party, right? So you have every time you need this, you need to do this. So you have two actors, and this guy says rock, this guy says paper, but they don't reveal it. They reveal it to a trusted trusted third party. So they reveal it here, and then the trusted third party collects it. It's asynchronous, so this guy can go first, then this guy goes, and so on. And then this guy says, okay, atomically, it was R and P, right? So it's the same as, you know, this guy transferring money to this guy, right? So it says, I have 100, and this guy has 0. Now we need to atomically change the transaction ledger, right? We have to say, this guy has 50, and this guy has 50. Well, so this guy submits the transaction. The trusted third party says, okay, now you have 50 and you have 50. And that's an atomic operation, right? So with the blockchain and Bitcoin, we know we can do the ledger part. We can do this because we have this trusted third party now being the Bitcoin network or the blockchain network. But for the generic computations, for like playing rock, paper, scissors, or for doing communication, or for doing whatever else, like in general sense, that's where we kind of need the computing platform to be more general, right? So we can do that with a simple contract. So the simple contract is this. Instead of having a trusted third party, we submit a hash to a chain, right? So this guy says, I will use a nonce of some sort, so nonce one, and then I will hash rock. And then it reveals publicly the hash, right? So it says, that's my hash. It can happen asynchronously. This guy does the same. So it uses P, it uses some you know, secret, some nonce, hashes that, and then reveals it to everybody, to the network. So you have some sort of a public infrastructure where those announcements can happen, right? So then, and it can be asynchronous, right? So now you want a computing module, once those two announcements happen, to ask them or to trigger that now you have to announce nouns, right? So the first step is to announce the hash. The second step is to reveal the secrets. And once the secrets are revealed, one of these guys wins, right? Because one of them has paper and it beats rock. So once the second step happens, that the secrets are revealed, that computing module can take the hash, can take the secret, can take the hash, take the secret, calculate R and P, decide P is better than R, and says, this guy won, he gets the award, right? And you can do that. You can do that with a simple contract, and you can write it in Ethereum and have it work, yep.
Yeah, I get a question. So in this example, the nonce is going to be used to solve the input of the hash value, hash function?
Yes, yeah, to solve the choice, right? Because if they hash directly, it could be, yeah, by brute force, right? Okay, so what we need is we need kind of publicly available computing module. We need everybody to be able to access it. Everybody needs to be able to verify that it does what it's supposed to do. And it is verifiable, same as the blockchain. So that's what that's what Ethereum is. It's a kind of a global computing platform where you can write those simple contracts and you can execute them and you can have it sort of do what we just said in theory, but in practice. So we are kind of running out of time, but Solidity is this sort of language that uses the those principles, and I had the rock, paper, scissors has been implemented already in Ethereum. You can play it, so you can bet against other players and play rock, paper, scissors, and if you lose, you lose the deposit. If you win, you get the deposit of another person. So you put a little bit of money, and then you vote, and then if you win, you get the other guy's money, but if you were correct, I mean, if you were correctly winning, you get it. If you lost, you lost, and it happens automatically, right? So it's kind of a smart contract that happens. And as you go to the website, from the slides, you will notice that after this simple rock, paper, scissors, the Ethereum kind of now has lots of different games of chance where you can play on the chain and engage with other players without the house, right? So one of the interesting properties of it is that, like, if I want to play rock, paper, scissors with you asynchronously with a third party, I usually have to pay a bit of a fee to the third party because for facilitating that interaction. But if we're doing it on the open platform like this, we can avoid paying fees, right? So now you can go to like a gambling house where there is no house. You can play gambling games just against other players without the house being this sort of, you know, house which always takes a little bit of money from everybody, right? You can have insurance policies where you say, you know, we as Jovik citizens, let's insure everybody ourselves, and then we will pay premiums to each other in case of some, you know, natural disasters. But there is no insurance company which takes, you know, whatever percentage they always take to make profits, right? So you can have certain systems which kind of run without a trusted third party anymore. So people discuss insurance, people discuss like Uber or Airbnb being put on the blockchain instead of being run by a single entity. So you can have more democratic process in managing that. You can have less, you know, less leakage of the funds to that entity which manages that. There are projects which run, which try to run like software repositories in the IPFS and with the blockchain as well. So there is a number of different things which blockchain enables. So I think we sort of we exceeded a little bit the time frame that I allocated. I was hoping that we will have the Ethereum clients right now working. We can track some of the transactions. I can give you some of the testnet tokens that I have, and you can mine some yourself. But we can kind of do that offline, right? So you can, once the slides are revealed, I can tell you what to do. So we can mine some testnet ether, and then I can show you some simple contract of how they work. And we can do a little bit of investigation of how the money were transferred, but that would have to happen offline. So as the final thing, I was thinking of discussing with you where the blockchains are being kind of used. And I have a Prezi presentation, so I can talk a little bit about the implications of what it means. So the technology is hyped, as you mentioned, but it is also very powerful. So it allows you to achieve certain things in untrusted environments, and it also allows you to achieve certain things with the collection of people who not necessarily trust each other, right? So there are some projects, for example, like banks typically don't share their data, right? They don't share financial data with each other. So every bank is doing their own fraud detection themselves. But what it means is organization or, you know, terrorist group which wants to do some money laundering, they can use multiple banks or multiple institutions to sort of, in each one, it looks kind of okay, but if you do it across multiple ones on the global scale, or clearly there is a pattern that you're misusing the system. But because banks don't share the data, they don't see that. But if there was a mechanism for them to share the data with such a way that certain things can be verified without revealing the details of the data, then suddenly they can do global analytics without actually revealing the data, right? So there are projects like that. There are projects which deal with insurance as well. So if I'm an insurance company, I have certain events that happen which makes me to pay premiums, and I have certain situations when I collect the premiums for myself, right? So the money flow is like I have some money coming in from people, and some events influence me, and those events cause some money to go out, right? But then because, and I also have some categories of users, and I have some categories of events. And I'm as an insurer, I'm collecting statistics, and I'm trying to optimize my sort of pipeline in such a way that you know, I'm positive, you know, cash-wise. So if that happens for all the insurers, and insurers also use kind of reinsurer to offload some of the risks they're taking, that information is not shared. But if they share that information, they could do this more efficiently, right? So there is an initiative from the insurance industry to sort of share more data. There is a lot of work happening in IoT for electrical grids to share information about the energy consumption and also real-time betting on to make the markets more efficient, right? Yes, so there is, most of those domains which I mentioned, they want data to be not revealed, but they want some of the properties of the data to be revealed. So they don't want the actual transaction data to be revealed, but they want, for example, to be able to calculate some analytics on the data. So they use some of homomorphic encryption schemas to hide the actual data, right? The blockchains are used for verifiability and sort of engagement, but not for the actual data sharing. Yeah. So we have kind of a number of categories of people who use the blockchain. So it started with technology enthusiasts and some libertarians, but currently commercial interests are kind of growing, and criminal interests are also growing. So I have a couple of slides which are used for which are using blockchain for kind of criminal activities. Mostly it boils down to currencies. So blockchains in the context of currencies are being used for tracking the funds. So they're kind of used as an equivalent of cash, right? So instead of using cash to hide your tracks, you're using virtual currencies to hide your tracks. And a lot of so Dash, Monero, Cloak, and Nava, those are initiatives which are anonymity-enhanced protocols which criminals really like. So in one of the... So what is the largest dark web marketplace that you know that has been busted a few times by FBI? Silk Road, right? So every time Silk Road is busted, it kind of reappears. Like, why? You know, there is a market, producers and consumers, right? There are people who want to buy drugs and there are people who want to sell drugs, right? So it's not the problem with technology, it's the problem with the ecosystem. So the ecosystem is organized in such a way that there is a need, and that it will, this kind of dark web marketplaces will continue to reappear because you know, there is the need for buying something and there is a need for selling something. So they very quickly adopted Bitcoin. So the Silk Road 1 and 2, they were using Bitcoin. But the latest marketplaces are using Dash and Monero as well. So those are growing in popularity currency systems, which are being used in those sort of dark web marketplaces. And they have as strong anonymity and privacy as the libertarians or as, you know, security conscious experts. So there are a couple of slides here. So dark web marketplaces. So we have some statistics. We don't have to go into details. There are some hype, as we were saying, and there is a lot of you know, terrorists being funded by dark marketplaces and so on. Most of it is actually fake. So most terrorist funding sites are scams to scam the people supporting terrorists out of their money, basically, right? There is a lot of murder for hire and so on in the dark web too. Most of it is not real neither. What is interesting is that we were discussing mixing services. They kind of reappear as well as the analytics industry. So from law enforcement, there was a huge boost in startups and companies which were doing blockchain transaction analytics to tell you which transactions are coming from the dark web, which are kind of non dark web related, what your customers are doing to track criminals and so on, like human trafficking, payments and weapon traffic payments and so on. So as that was happening, on the other end, there was a race of making it even harder to track, right? So it's sort of an arm race happening there. It's again kind of interesting because there are fake mixing services, so they advertise themselves as mixing services, but in fact they are fake, and also some vanity address generators. So you can have a kind of a, because as with the hashing, you can say I want a particular hash with particular properties, I want some letters or something up front, and then somebody can generate a particular address for you if they have enough computing resources and give you the private and public key for it. So if you want, you know, an address with saying Mariusz up front, right, I can get one, but then I have to trust that the vanity address generator didn't leak my public private key, because if they keep my private key, they have access to that address. So we had, most of it doesn't directly relate to blockchains. The interesting thing is most of extortion cases don't use cash anymore. So those scenes in the film where you get a call to drop some bag of cash somewhere on the street, that almost never happens anymore. So all victims are asked to transfer bitcoins or other currency somewhere. Those data are kind of from the recent reports from Europol and the statistics that they collect. Of course, not all the statistics get through, but most data is sort of accurate. So the interesting one is that so ransomware kind of happened because now if your computer is infected, you can be asked to make a Bitcoin deposit and it's easy to track. In the past, if the payments had to be done through cash, that was not really feasible business model, right? You can't really ask people to do that. And then if the deposits were done through any of the other electronic transmitting protocols, they were traceable. So the emergence of virtual currencies kind of made it possible for ransomware to become abundant. And the ransomware usually works like this, that you get some malware, it encrypts your hard drive, and then you can get the key if you pay. If you don't, you don't get the key, so your stuff is encrypted. And it works quite well to a point where your backups are infected as well, right? So as you see on the slide, it's sort of, we don't know exactly how many are infected, because you know, companies and individuals don't really report, especially if you are a public company, you don't want to confirm. But there were a couple of interesting cases. One interesting case was with the hotel in Austria during the ski season last year. Somebody installed a malware on the registration desk computer in such a way that they couldn't issue the electronic cards. The electronic card keys were not working anymore, right? So people who were outside of their room couldn't get in to their rooms. And the hotel paid the ransom to get that unlocked, right? And that was the second time they were hit, and they paid twice. But after the second time, they decided to drop the electronic keys and go back to the physical keys. So instead of improving their security, they sort of decided that it's much cheaper for them to just drop the those credit card-like RFID kind of keys. The other interesting thing is that ransomware became so popular that it became kind of given as a service. So you can go to a dark marketplace and buy your stakes in the, some sort of a ransomware run as a service, and then you will share some of the, like, usually you are given it for free, but then you have to share some of the profits you're making with the original software vendor for that software, right? So all the victims you inflict, you get like, I don't know, 80%, and the vendor takes 20 or something. So that's kind of interesting. What does this? Oh yeah, that's also interesting. So addresses are quite long. You've seen those hashes. You're not gonna type them. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna copy and paste them, right? So if you want to transfer money to someone, you're usually copying your address and pasting it into a transaction and saying send or something like this. There are malware which replace, they detect which are the hashes for the Bitcoin or Ethereum addresses. And every time you're doing copy and paste of the address they think is the Bitcoin address, they inject their own. So then, you know, instead of transferring money to what you thought you are transferring money to, you transfer money to an attacker. And it's really hard if you're doing Control C, Control V to notice that the hash changed under your fingerprints, right? Fingertips. So those are kind of interesting clipboard malware which emerged because of the blockchains. Yeah, almost everybody was hacked. So all the big networks, and starting with, you know, some inside jobs of Mt. Gox, most initiatives are always hit by an attack, and it's either smaller or bigger. The modern way is to offload your risk to the blockchain itself. So most most exchanges, they have a concept of a hot wallet. So that's where the funds are kind of easily available. And the cold wallet, which is something either stored in the chain itself or stored offline. And there are some cryptocurrency exchanges which are using smart contracts to decouple their operations from the actual operation of the blockchain itself. So for example, if I run a kind of a conceptual exchange for exchanging Ether for Bitcoin, right? You can, we can use a system where I never really physically store any currency myself. I just run a smart contract which has a multisig, and multisig is a concept where to release the funds you need more than one signature, right? So we can have a multisig where you transfer, you make a deposit, and another party makes the Ether deposit. And then once those two deposits are done, I sign both, release the funds, and swap them. And that means that I never really hold any funds myself. I only take the deposits which are hanging in the blockchain for a while, and then atomically swap the value. So then if I'm hacked, I can't really lose funds. It is possible to lose some funds if the private keys are kind of leaked, right? So the hack may involve getting hold of the private keys, and then you're sort of doomed. All right, so we will be sort of wrapping up. Do you have questions? What do you think is interesting as a final remark? So there was a question about hype. Yeah, definitely, there is a lot of hype, and some of the things are not quite true. Governments and financial institutions are looking, and banks are